God for this good testimony today. Amen. Thank God for the spirit of worship. Thank God for all of the songs that went out. Scripture says in favor, we used to say in favor of right living. Amen. Just thank God for this good. We just want to share this morning in prayer just for a moment. I could have continued upon the praise and worship. Amen. It was just so rich this morning. If everybody would just let go, let God. Everybody enter in. The worship would be so much more meaningful to all of us. So we want to encourage all of you that twiddling your thumbs and looking wise and otherwise. We want to encourage you to enter in. Enter in. Amen. The Lord wants to be worshipped, is that right? In spirit and in truth. So let's just continue the spirit of worship this morning. But then in a few minutes, Father, we thank you. Oh God, you've been so good to all of us. You've been so mindful of us. Oh God, we thank you, Lord, that your mercy and good have. Oh, we thank you, Lord, that you are more than enough to be concerned about all that the things that concerns us. We give you praise and glory this morning for the work that you've begun in us. We believe the work that you have begun in us, you will continue to perform. Father, we give you the praise and the glory. Thanking you, Lord, magnifying you, giving you the glory that's due your name. Hallelujah. Thank you for this day. Oh, you're worthy. I'm going to just lift your hands and say, Lord, you're worthy. Say, Lord, you're worthy. Worthy to receive riches, glory, honor, dominion, power. Bought us with a great price. Glorify you and our bodies which belong to you. We give you the praise and the glory today in Jesus' name. Everybody just say in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. 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 Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I just want to just say this evening at 5 o'clock, we're going to ask all of those that weren't able to attend on Wednesday. This is going to be the way that we will be operating. Those that can't come to Bible study, this church noted for prayer, Bible study. Things are not going to be right unless you Bible study and pray. And all leaders and those that's involved and members, amen, this is your responsibility to support your church, amen, to support the vision, to place yourself in a position where you can be blessed, because half of us out of Bible study is going to affect the Sunday morning service. It's going to impact people when they come. All of it is tied together. People can tell where the Spirit of the Lord is. Amen. In unity, there is what? Strength. Amen. So we're going to ask everybody to keep that in mind, that we're going to be expecting. I have all of the list. I have a list already written out of those that's supposed to show up.
Alrighty.
I have it already written out. I have a list of all of those that did show up. Yeah. Amen. So I just want you to be, I want you to govern yourselves accordingly. Okay, I want to just share with you, since so many, I know so many are out because of the job schedules and things of that nature. So it's going to be necessary for us to do some things different and have these studies, and I'm going to call extra prayer times too. That's the only way that we will be able to unite the body, is that we have to have other prayer times, we have to have other Bible study times in order to everybody to be available, amen, and to be a part of the prayer and the Bible study. Amen. I want to talk about something today that would be a real blessing to you. Because we want everybody in a position where we can fulfill the will of God in our life. And one of the components, I feel that is foundational, that we've been talking about foundational issues. One of the most important of those foundational components will be holiness. Everybody just say holiness.
Holiness.
Holiness. Amen. I'm going to talk about the importance of holiness, what holiness is, and the importance of holiness. This is in the life of the believer. You know, everybody said holiness is important. Tell somebody around you, holiness is important. Amen. So we want to know what holiness is, and we want to know why is it so important. I got a scripture. I guess probably everybody could just think from the top of your head. The scripture says, without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Without holiness, so that makes it important. But if I don't read nothing else, without holiness, no man shall what? See the Lord. And I want to give you a scripture, 1 Thessalonians 12 and 13. It says this, and the Lord make you to increase and abound in love one toward another and toward all men, even as we do toward you. And the Lord make you to increase and abound in love one toward another and toward all men, even as we do toward you. To the end, he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God, even our Father, at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all of his saints. So scripture says that by us increasing and abounding in love one toward another and toward all men, that means that we have to be concerned about those within and those without. To the end, he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God. So in order to be established in holiness, it's going to be a love issue. We have to perfect love. Scripture says, perfect love casteth out fear. And whenever your heart is assured, when we do what God says do, then the Bible says, then we have confidence toward God. We have confidence toward God. So that is very important, that we do what God says do, so that our hearts would be established in holiness. Amen. There's another scripture that I'm sure that you memorize and you can relate to, 2 Corinthians 7:1. Beginning at the 14th verse in the 6th chapter, it tells about, this is one aspect of holiness, is separation. We're going to give you all of these definitions shortly. It says, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, or what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord had Christ with Belial, or what part had he that believeth with an infidel? What agreement had the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God, as God hath said, I will dwell in them, walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, said the Lord. Touch not the unclean thing. 2 Corinthians 6. Okay. 2 Corinthians 6, but lead up to 7 verse. Okay. And so the students of Revival wouldn't have had a problem. They knew that 2 Corinthians 7:1 is a culmination of the previous verses. Okay, well, we'll just we'll just apologize. All right. And be ye separate, said the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. Amen. So that's a prerequisite for God receiving us. And will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. Okay, 2 Corinthians 7:1. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Okay, I'm going to just give you some insight into some things that would be very helpful to you. I want you to maybe take note. When it says separation, holiness is actually separation. It's a process in which the believer purifies and separates himself from moral evil externally and internally. Now, let me just say that it's a process in which the believer separates himself from moral evil externally and internally. This is a process which extends throughout life. I just want you to understand that this process continues throughout life. As the spirit develops and become strong, it will bring our mind and body into subjection to the word, and holiness in our daily walk will become more and more apparent. The believer is commanded to separate himself from the ungodly. Everybody said ungodly. That's the scripture I just read in 2 Corinthians 6. We are to separate ourselves from the ungodly. That means that we are not to develop close relationships and associations with people that are ungodly, because they can discourage you, they can what impact you, they can what cause you to what be distracted. So this doesn't mean that you can't work with people that's unsaved or own jobs and all of that. This means that you are not to develop intimate connections, intimate associations with these people. For instance, like, if you're on a job, you have to what? You have to work. Is that right? You're going to be dealing with a whole lot of people that's ungodly. I don't care what walk of life you are involved. You're going to be dealing with people that are what? Ungodly. But you do have some choices. You don't have to follow them home. You don't have to what? Go to their parties. At noon, when they all congregate and tell all of these lies and all of these negative things, how many know that when the world gets together, they have, I mean, a whole lot of nasty stuff comes out? Amen. So you're not to connect. I remember Sister Neal used to say that on her job, many times at noon, she would go out with some of her friends, but they respected her, and if they said something out of order, they always apologized. So that fear. So you can demand a level of respect, even when you are in the company of unbelievers. But many days, she's remained in her office and just read her Bible or just meditate or just read, period. So we're not to get involved with intimate relationships, going to parties where I'll hang out with them, and or be in their presence to the extent where you can impact you or distract you from the things that God really would have you to do. So this scripture is said that we're to come out from among them and be what? Separate. That's the reason Israel was called out to be what? Holy unto God. They were not to what? Intermingle with a whole lot of the worldly are people that did not have a what? The fear of God. They were not to build intimate relationships with those people. So Moses made laws and statutes and ordinances that caused Israel to be a separate nation. They had to abide by these ordinances, amen, in order to be free from a whole lot of the evil influences and corruption, amen, that had a tendency to corrupt them. So from ungodly, from evil influences, how many of you know what evil influences would be? Amen. Evil influences would be things like drug environment, right? Dealers and users, many TV, television shows, and programs would be evil influence. I'm not going to lie, man, it's now. Everything on television is not what wholesome. You have to really screen the things that you what feed on television. Now you have to remember, a lot of these people that produce these programs are people that don't have any what fear of God at all. Many of them are what are perverted. Many of them are dealing with drug issues. A whole gang of them are people that have are in relationships that are not what pleasing to God. Is that right? Adultery, fornication, amen, profanity. Now, if you don't feed on that kind of stuff, amen, you can see what the reason why, amen, you have to be fucked up so much on Sunday morning, even just to get a little teeny with a teeny bit of joy. If you don't, with all of the Bible says, don't love the world, neither the things that are what? In the world. Amen. You can't love the world and be a friend of God. Scripture says that a friend of the world is automatically an enemy of God. Amen. I believe that our spirituality would improve 75 or 80% if we would just, amen, stop looking at some of that mess on television. Amen. Nothing on amens now. Amen. I think that, I know sometimes I have a tendency to watch the news, and you know, I think that even too much news will corrupt your mind, right? Oh, amen, this thing down in Florida. What's the thing going thing down? Everybody caught up in what? Amen. That stuff can really get into your spirit and really begin to what? Impact you and distract you from what? The things of God. So sometimes we need to what? Just shut it off. Everybody say, shut it off. Pull out your Bible. We watch that so long when the time comes for us to read our Bibles, we don't what? Amen. We don't have no appetite for it. Amen. We've been watching all of the exciting stuff on TV. We are so hyped up until we just don't have no appetite for the Bible. So we have to, Scripture says in Psalms 101:3, I will set no wicked thing before my eyes. That's the Scripture with David said, I will set no wicked thing before my eyes. All right, so we have television shows, many television shows and programs are corrupt. Profane music. All right, anybody listening to me? They have music, which is what? Of the devil. Profane. It doesn't glorify God. It doesn't build you, edify you. It's really going to what? Take from you and cause you to what? Get further and further away. Now, somebody said, a man of God said, sin is anything that cools your affection off toward God. Anything that will cool you off and cause you to be less sensitive, amen, to the things of God that take away your desire from the things of God, that thing is sin to you. Anybody here? Is everybody gone? All right, that's what sin is. Sin is to you. Anything that will cool you off and take away from you the things that what you have established, amen, in terms of your spiritual walk with the Lord. All right, so these are things that Scripture mentioned about all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life. All of this is not of what? Is of the world, not of the Father. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, See, that's the thing, that these things can lead to the lust of the what? Flesh. Anything that you see more than like it, at some point, it has the tendency to what? Cause lust to rise up. Amen. That's the reason why we are not to get caught up in worldly music and worldly dance, because it's designed to stimulate you and to cause what? Lust to rise up. Amen. How many can say amen?
Amen.
All right. So what they call this dancing program now? Stars or what is it? Dancing with the Stars. Okay, now, anybody that watch that kind of stuff, but you know, sometimes I momentarily look at it, and then I switch it, I say, I can't look at nothing like this. Amen. Because it's going to what? Impact you. Amen. Well, if somebody said, well, I'm too old to be moved by that. Then you start, well, go back 20 years. Oh, I used to do that. Oh, how much pleasure I had in doing things like that. So, the scripture says we're to what? Touch not, taste not, handle not, things that have a tendency to entice us, to cause lust to be what? Stirred up. That's the reason why you can't deal with that type of music and dance, because it causes what? Lust to what? Get stirred up. If you're normal. Amen. But if you're normal, if you're abnormal and it don't bother you, it still ain't good. The Bible says what? I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes, right? You're wasting time. Ain't nobody going to pay you for looking at that, right? There's nothing to gain from that. So the Bible says that we're not to have any connection with evil influences. Separation, all right. Separation from what? All evil influences. Y'all going to love me before it's over, because I'm showing you how you can get closer to God, and why you won't be so dry, amen, even on Sunday morning, and why we won't have to be but try to pull the praises out of you.
All
right. With all of that stuff, amen, all packed up in you, all, amen, all, my God, amen, all in your mind and your spirit, and amen, how can you have a desire to worship the Lord? So holiness has a whole lot to do with pleasing the Lord. How many can say amen?
Amen.
All right, some sports. Now, I think that the Bible says love not the world. I think that sometimes you can get so involved even in worldly stuff, sports. Although in itself is not wrong, but you can make what? You can cause it to be a what? Stumbling block. If you're going to watch that 3 hours and can't read your Bible for 3 hours a week, by 30 minutes. Amen. Well, things like this, these are designed to what? Cool you off spiritually. To cause your praise and worship what? To dry up. And your love and adoration for the Word of God to what? Decline. And it doesn't take a whole lot. It can be a good thing you're doing, right? Amen. It can what? It can take away your time that you have devoted to the Lord. That's where the sin comes in. Amen. Some things are corrupt by nature, but some things you do are not corrupt in itself. But it takes away your time. And sin is anything that takes away time. Remember, Wednesday night, we said the Bible, we gave to you that we're going to be judged according to how we use our time and talents and our resources. Is that right? And the Bible says redeeming the time, because the days are what? Evil. We ain't got no time to waste. Amen. We barely can pray in the Spirit. Barely have a desire to read our word. Amen. Barely can get to church. Barely, barely, barely. And here we are feeding on all of this stuff that's taking us, what, further and further away. Now, if you come to church 7 days a week, maybe you can take a little bit more of this stuff if it's wholesome. All right, amen. I'm just not going over. All right, gambling. Now, if y'all saw me up at the casino, Sister Hill and I, last night we were coming in from Arkansas, and we saw this sign that said, lunch and dinner, amen. And I said, I got excited because it was out in North Tulsa. And I looked up there and said, the casino. All right. Now, I said, I don't. personally, I don't, you know, think that maybe by me going there and having done that would be wrong. But the Bible says, what, shun the very appearance of evil. Boy, you never would hear the end of it if I was caught out there and I was in the casino. See, some of y'all go to the casino, y'all like it. But I can't go, so there's a different standard for you and me, see. But the Bible, it puts it all in the what? Same category, shunning the very what? Appearance of evil. And things like that can cool you off, can zap your joy, can get your mind in a state where the Bible, you can just read the Bible and it doesn't what? Say nothing to you. And we got enough to deal with without what? Finding something else. Amen. How many got some problems you're dealing with? Amen. Amen. In other realms, in other areas.
Yes.
Amen. Well, let me move on. All right. Now, these are evil influences. Everybody say evil influences.
Evil.
All right. So, separation supposed to go across the board. See, this is the reason why the level of spirituality in this generation, this is the reason why we're living in the Laodicean age. It's the age in which, amen, spirituality will go to its lowest peak. And the Bible says that the Laodicean church will be a church that's neither cold nor hot. They just don't have the joy that we used to have. They don't have the interest in the word. They don't have the commitment. Amen. I think that everybody ought to come to church at least once a week. At least once a week. And I don't see how you can really make it just by coming what? Just don't study alone. I don't see it. Amen. Maybe you can see more than I can see. All right. But we want to understand that God is still calling for what? Separation. Separation from the ungodly. Everybody said the ungodly. Separation from evil influences. All right? Separation from ungodly Christians. Everybody said ungodly Christians. There are so many negative, whining, Christians with bad attitudes. And every time you get with them, they're what? Talking about somebody else. They always bring up a whole lot of what? Negative. Anybody ever heard negative Christians? Well, the Bible says, mark them, well, not to company with fornicators, but it also says, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you have learned and avoid them. There are some Christians you need to what? Avoid. Love them, be friendly, be kind. Amen. If you cook the cake, offer them some. If not sweet as you can be. But try to what? Avoid them, especially when they get on the phone and start what? Talking. Then you say, well, I'm seeing some people I do that with. They'd be on the phone for 2 hours, all day, if I would hold that phone to my ear. They would be there all day long. They just like to talk. They talk about everything under the sun. Then I have to, at some point, I says, I'm sorry, brother, I have an appointment. I got to go. I got to do this. Even if it's just reading the Bible or praying. Get with Sister Hill on some issue. I said, I got something I got to do. I try to what? Get off. And sometimes when the phone rang, I see that number. Amen, praise God. I just let that call go by. And after they call, maybe a half a dozen times, I pick it up and talk with them for a little bit. But I try to dominate the conversation. All right, so you have to avoid. You have to protect your spirits. Amen. How many can say amen?
Amen?
All right, the Bible says, withdraw yourselves from every brother that walk disorderly and not after the tradition which he received of us. This is 2 Thessalonians 3:9. All right. Withdraw yourselves from every brother that walketh disorderly and not after the tradition which he received of us. All right, so you're talking about what? Separation? Everybody says separation. So sanctification has a lot to do with what? Separation. Scripture says in 1 Corinthians 5:9, not to company with fornicators. If you know somebody that's in immorality, the Bible says don't what? Don't company with them. All right. Now, 2 Thessalonians 3:14. If any man obey not our word by this epistle, know that man and have no covenant with him, that he may be ashamed. So the scripture is talking about what? Separation. Everybody says separation. 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 Amen. If they're coming to you and bring up this doctrine, receive them not into your house. These are Jehovah's Witnesses. Or any people that teach what? False doctrine. It could be, amen, once in Christ, never out people. It could be, you gotta be baptized a certain way. If they're coming to you and bring them to this doctrine, bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. That's 2 John 10:11. So it's a lot about separation. Everybody says separation. Sanctification is a lot about what? Separation. From the ungodly, from evil influences, from ungodly believers, from ungodly teaching and doctrines. I'm not going to say too much about that. And separation from our own carnal nature. That's what 2 Corinthians 7:1 said. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Now, when it comes to the filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness, this is going to involve a little bit more than just separation from people. Because, amen, separation from your own kind of ways and fleshly desires, that goes deep, that involves you, and you can't get away from you unless you what? Deal with you. How many can say amen? So the only way you can deal with cleansing yourself from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God, the only way you can deal with that is that you have to renew the mind. This comes through what? Renewing the man. Okay, now this has to come strictly. See, there's a part of sanctification which you can accomplish just through separation. Because if you separate yourself from ungodly people, from evil influences, from ungodly Christians, and so forth and so on, that means that the less influence you have with evil stuff, that means what? Less problems are you going to have with what? Temptation. But that's not going to do the whole job. I mean, y'all look at me straight. Amen. The real job, the stuff that involves you, amen, and changing you, your evil tendencies, your evil ways, your evil desire, the works of the flesh, amen, those things are going to be had, those things are going to be dealt with, amen, in a different way. And I'm just going to just share that with you because I think, all right, now, concerning the flesh, Romans 13:14, it says, make no provisions for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. So this is how you deal with your flesh. Make no provision for it. In other words, if you have a tendency to you really get stirred up when you watch the Dancing with the Stars, that means what? You don't what? You don't watch it. You don't turn it on. Make no provisions. And when you turn it on, and you know you're weak in the flesh, in that area, then you're making what? Provisions for it. When you know that you can be, amen, cigarettes, that is a real problem for you, and you figure out how you can borrow some money to come up with enough to buy a pack of cigarettes, then you're making what? Provisions. If you know that this, amen, this person creates a temptation for you, I mean, this is speaking about sexual attractions, and then if you, amen, praise God, place yourself in a position where you can what? You can be tempted, amen, in other words, going over to a single person's house at night, nobody there, and you're weak in the flesh, and, amen, Bible says every man is tempted when he's what? Drawn away of his own what? Lust and enticed. And when a person has been enticed, the scripture says that that can lead to what? To sin. When you get tempted and you place yourself in a what? Position to what? Amen. To be for more and more and more enticement, it's going to what? Eventually cause you to what? To give in or to let your what? Let your, amen, let your what? Guards down. So come out from among them. Michael says what? Come out from among them. Amen. Don't make provisions for the flesh. In other words, amen, some says, well, I'm going to the casino, but I'm not going to gamble. I'm just going to watch everybody else. I just want to just, okay, but you make a provision, right? Okay, then you give me another illustration of making provision. Somebody just give me one right quick. Make a provision. Nobody can think of one? Okay, being around somebody smoking weed, all right.
I was a drug addict. I asked for God to take me away from all that.
Right.
And now I don't see them. And I don't try to go around because I'm tempted when they come to me.
Right.
And say, hey, come on, let's go.
So you have to stay away, right?
If God has removed it, I shall not
remove it. All right. Well, that's right. That's what I mean. Make no provision for the flesh to fulfill the what? The desire. All
right.
Okay, now, let's talk about tithing. God wants us to tithe, but how can we make provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust? We find something else that gets our attention before the tithe is paid. Is that right? That might be a poor illustration. But how many people find something else to do with their money before they get it to the church where they, how many find something else to do? And sometimes you place yourself, well, I'm going out to eat. And they know the only way they can eat is what? On tithe money. Now you're making what? Provision for your flesh to what? Fulfill your desire at the expense of what? Disobeying God. I know a whole lot of people go out and spend $60 eating out. They make them feel good. Oh, I just feel so good when I just go out and just eat what I want. Amen. All right. So I have 10 scriptures here that deals with concerning the flesh, how we are to deal with the flesh. Now the scripture says, "We're the circumcision. We worship the Lord in the Spirit. We have we rejoice in Jesus Christ, and we have no confidence in the flesh. We the circumcision. That's Philippians 3:3, I believe. We the circumcision, we worship the Lord in the Spirit, we rejoice in Jesus Christ. Now this is something that you can do to counteract the problems in the flesh. Worship the Lord in the Spirit. Everybody say, worship the Lord in the Spirit. All right, so we're trying to tell you how you can get out of the flesh, because we've got to separate ourselves from our own what? Fleshly ways that what? Prevent us from what? Having God's best. Worship of the Lord in spirit, rejoicing in Jesus Christ, and what? Having no confidence in the what? Amen. Because the scripture says, in the flesh there dwelleth what? No good things. So you can't trust your flesh. Amen. So you have to what? Make no provisions for it. I mean, the flesh is already untrustworthy, right? So why would you want to what? Make provision for what you know is already what? Untrustworthy. You know that ain't going to work. All right. Now, I'm going to show you the scriptures that I have in mind for how to deal with your flesh. Now, because separation got to go across the board. But just separation in itself is not going to what? Do the job in every realm. Because when it comes to the flesh, you got to do something spiritual in order to what? To really bring your flesh in subjection. How many can say amen to that? All right, now here is the thing that holiness is also the process in which we conform to the image of Christ, which also extends throughout our lifetime and come to full fruition only when we see the Lord. All right, believers are admonished to perfect holiness in the fear of God. Now, in order to perfect holiness in the fear of God, this is a process which we call conforming to the image of Christ. Okay, this is what we have to do in order to do that. Believers are exhorted to walk as becoming saints. In order to live a holy life, the believer must present his body to the Lord. That's the first thing. The believer has to present his what? Body to the Lord. In other words, you got to do something about your what? Physical body. You got to keep it under what? Control. Amen. The scripture says, Sister Neal, amen. Present your body a what? Living sacrifice, what? Holy, acceptable unto the Lord, which is your what? All right. Okay, 12:1. Okay, now what that means is that you have to yield your members as instruments of righteousness and not as instruments of unto sin. You have to yield your members. Yield your members as instruments. So that does involve, amen, separation in the other areas that I mentioned up above, but it goes much deeper than just separating yourself from somebody. Amen. You got to present your body. That means what? You got to submit, the Bible says, submit yourself to God and resist the devil. That means what? Might be some consecration involved, right? You got to bring those members in what? In subjection. Paul said, I keep my body, what? Turn to 1 Corinthians 9, and you'll see what Paul did. I keep my body, and you know how Paul kept his body in subjection. Right? Right? 24. 9:24. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize. So run that ye may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. So temperance has got to be what? A cardinal virtue when it comes to what? Getting victory over your flesh. And I think I said something there. Temperance. Everybody said temperance. Temperance. Okay, now, the things that usually cause the most problem would be overeating. And then these are sins that usually cause problems. Eating, sex, and what would be called lust of the flesh. In other words, desires, things that we desire. These are the things that usually cause most problems. Amen. Overeating. Because most sins will emanate from what? Not being temperate. In that particular area. That was the sin of Sodom. The first thing they mentioned was what? Fullness of brain. Pride of life. Abundance of idleness. See, all of these things and the failure to strengthen the hand of the needy. But the mother sin of all of that, of all of those things mentioned in Ezekiel 16:19, that caused Sodom to be destroyed, the mother sin, what do I mean by mother sin? The root of all of it was what? They were the fullness of bread. How many know most time fullness of bread? Every event, when we have to what? We eat. Is that right? Most events, people what? They like to eat. Is that right? And then they like to eat what until they are what? Full. Makes them feel good. Alright. Eating and drinking, that was the thing that caused the flood to come and take them away. Jesus said that, take heed to yourself, lest the cares of life, and what else? Surfington, The Cares of Life, and something else comes, Luke 21:34. Okay. Y'all still here?
Yeah.
Luke 21:34, I think he mentioned The Cares of Life. This is what Jesus said. I just want you to see what Jesus said. See, all of this is temperance, Luke 21:34. What does it say? Okay, so the day of Christ will come up, will more than likely come upon you unaware if you are really controlled by what? Surfeiting, the cares of life, drunkenness, and those are those things mentioned there. Okay, so everybody just said temperance. So you have to understand temperance is a cardinal virtue in terms of overcoming the flesh. Paul said that he had to what? He had to keep his body under what? I keep under my body. In other words, I keep my body under what? Control. I guarantee you, every athlete and musician, everybody that's professional, most of them, they have to what? They have to what? Work on their what? They have to work on their body to keep it what? To keep it under. Amen. He said, therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight out, not as one that beateth the air. We're back at 1 Corinthians 9. But I keep under my body and bring it into what? Subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a what? Cast away. So that means that we're going to have to what? Live a temperate life. Turn to somebody and say, live a temperate life. I mean, overcoming the flesh means what? You got to what? Present your body a what? Living sacrifice. Give your body, give your members to what? To the Lord. Your members got to be what? An instrument of righteousness, not an instrument that will what? Cause you to what? Get distracted from what? From the Word of God. All right. So that's how you overcome. That's one of the ways. You got to present your body. All right. Number two, you got to walk by the Word of God. That's the reason why I feel that every believer needs to be in what? Bible study. I mean, you can't even begin to overcome the flesh if you are not. Amen. If you're not what? Being taught. Some say, well, I can figure out all my answers myself. That's the problem already. All right. Everybody say, we got to what? Walk by the Word of God. Tell somebody you got to walk by the Word of the Lord. Amen. See, because this is the way that your mind is going to be what? Renewed. See, the only way you're going to overcome the flesh is that you got to what? Renew the mind by what? Yielding your members. Everybody say yielding your members. Secondly, you got to what? Walk by the Word. You got to what? Be a doer. Everybody say a doer. And the only way you can do the Word is you got to what? Know the Word. You got to submit to the fivefold ministry. You need to be in Sunday school. You need to be in what? A whole lot of teaching environments. And then when the women meet, you need to what? Show up. When the men meet, you need to what? Show up. Because there are going to be some things that will what? Help to get you where you need to be in terms of what? The Word of God. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
And be led by the Holy Spirit. All right, everybody said, be led by the Holy Spirit. In order to be led by the Holy Spirit, it's going to require the Word, is going to require what? Prayer. All of these disciplines that we are trying to get you to embrace. How else can you be led by the Holy Spirit unless you what? Pray. Pray in the Spirit. Meditate. Spend time with the Lord. All right, now the next thing. By being obedient to God and walking in love, amen, the Bible says you're bound more and more if you're what? Walk in love. How many know that just Walking in love, that means sow it into people's lives. Everybody say, sow it into people's lives. How many know that that's one of the biggest ways that you can what? Get out of your fleshly what? Way. Sow it to others. Everybody say, sow to others. I mean, sow into somebody's essence life. Encourage somebody. Talk with them. Pray with them. Get involved with people. Not just people within, but people as what? Without. How many know that's one of the greatest deterrents to overcoming your flesh? The greatest way. Get involved, because a whole lot of sins will what? Just automatically what? Amen. Evade you. Amen. You won't be tempted by it if you would just what? Get involved in what? In people. In other people's lives. That's the reason. Somebody said, idle man is a what? Devil's workshop. Everybody said, idle man. Get your man on television and all this idleness. You're going to what? Think more and more about what else you can do, what that's not pleasing to God. But when you begin to get involved with other people's lives, I'm finding this out. Amen. Your mind is going to be occupied more and more with what? Helping people, blessing people, ministering to people. And after a while, all of those thoughts and temptations and things that cause you to be distracted from the Word of God, those things are just going to what? Go away. That's the reason the Bible says, abound in love, what? Increase and abound in love more and more, to the end that you may be established in what? Holiness. Woo! Glory to God. All right, see, by being obedient to God and walking in love, progress in holiness is sure. You will definitely make progress in holiness. You will put to death the deeds of the body. Amen. The Holy Spirit will put to death the deeds of the body. When you do those things, when you present your body, I mean, that means temperance. Amen. When you are being, amen, when you are walking by the Word of God and when you're being led by the Holy Spirit, these are spiritual disciplines that you have to employ. Amen. By being obedient to God and walking in love, progress and sanctification is assured. The Holy Spirit will put to death the deeds of the body. In other words, what's going on in your body that's displeasing to God, the Holy Spirit will what? Put it to death. Squelch it. Woo! Isn't that good news? Everybody said, praise the Lord. The Holy Spirit will begin to what? Put to death the deeds of the body. The Holy Spirit will begin to work in you obedience to the Word of God. The Holy Spirit will begin to produce the fruit of the Spirit, peace, joy, love, meekness, gentleness. Woo! Glory. The Holy Spirit will automatically begin to what? Produce these virtues in you, which helps to what? Overrule the power of sin that's what? Controlling and prevailing in your life and operating through your flesh. How many know that the Bible says the Spirit of the law of life in Christ Jesus, amen, has made me what? Free from the law of what? What the law couldn't do. That it was weak. Amen. How many was weak in the flesh? Amen. You're trying to do what the Word says, but you are trying to do it by what? Works. How many can say amen? What the law can do, that it was weak in the flesh. God sent his only Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and condemned sin in the flesh so that the righteousness of the law might what? Praise God. Be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the what? After the Spirit. In other words, everything that's needed for you to walk in the Spirit, if you would just do those things, amen, praise God, do the Word. How many? Obey the Word. How many can say obey the Word?
Obey the Word.
Yield your body. Touch somebody and say, yield your body, baby. You don't need to be eating three pork chops. Pork chops. Not in one time. All right. You got to what? You got to get hold of that what? Your temper. You got to get hold of your body. Because your body belongs to what? It was bought with a price. You are to what? Glorify God in your body.
You can glorify God in your spirit and in your body, which belongs to God. All right, so that's a little bit of how you can overcome the flesh. Because we got to separate ourselves not only from bad folk and bad influences and bad Christians and bad teachers, but we got to separate ourselves from our own flesh. With the flesh. Everybody said the flesh wants to do a whole lot of stuff that's not consistent with God's word. So you have to put your foot down. You have to say no to the flesh. Break one of those little sayings and put a little X on it. Say no to the Everybody said no to the All right. Praise God. So I just wanted to just kind of share that with you this morning, but I'm not through with the sanctification issue, holiness issue. That was just a little snapshot of what's to come, because holiness is a big issue. Righteousness is something that we immediately, amen, receive when we're born again, and when Christ comes in, when Satan's dominion of our lives is broken, we do receive the righteousness of God. But holiness in reality, amen, is something that you have to walk. You got to walk in that righteousness. There's a job you got to do. How many can say amen?
Amen.
How many can say, everybody just stand on your feet today and say, Lord, thank you for perfecting me in holiness. Lord, thank you for perfecting me in holiness. Come on, lift your hands, lift your hearts right now. Say, Lord, we thank you.
Thank you.
Hey. Hallelujah. Hey, hallelujah.